Welcome again. This is second part of lecture on introduction to macroeconomics. Today I am continuing from the para I had left you in the last video. This lecture may be a bit long, so watch with patience and stay tuned till the last of the lecture. So let's start. Dear students, we were here in the last lecture. We have I have introduced you to the some elements of macroeconomics. We will continue from here, from this para. I am studying here. See at the top. Please give your concentration here. Give your attention here. Concentrate. While moving away from different goods and focusing on a representative good may be convenient. In the process, we may be overlooking some vital distinctive characteristics of individual goods. Okay, here what he wants to say that in the previous in the last para you have read that we can take one commodity and think it as representative good. For example, we have taken only one commodity and we thought that this would be the behavior of the whole commodities, all commodities in the market. But I am proceeding further. What is problem here? That vital distinctive characteristics of individual goods, all the characteristics of individual goods may be overlooked when we are considering only a one commodity case. For example, production conditions of agricultural and industrial commodities are of a different nature. Or if we treat a single category of labor as a representative of all kinds of laborers, we may be unable to distinguish the labor of the manager of a firm. So there is problem that there are many characteristics of an individual good which may be hidden. So here I have highlighted with the yellow labor of the manager of a firm and labor of the accountant of a firm. All these two labors are different, although both are laborers, but the characteristics of both these laborers are different. So taking a single commodity and generalize it for other commodities is not always true. So this is the main crux. So in many cases, I am reading here from where the yellow highlight and accountant of the firm. So in many cases, instead of a single representative category of good or labor or production technology, we may take a handful of different kinds of goods. For example, handful of commodities. Okay, we take in macroeconomics handful of commodities as representative of all commodities being produced within the economy. These are agricultural goods, industrial goods and services. So in agricultural goods we have clubbed all the commodities related with agriculture, and in industrial goods all the manufactured goods we are taking in industrial goods, and services for all services, maybe just banking, transport, etc. All these services are clubbed in one variable as services. Okay, let's proceed further. These goods may have different production technology and different prices. Macroeconomics also tries to analyze how the individual output levels, prices and employment levels of these different goods gets determined. So macroeconomics also deals with how the prices of agricultural goods will be determined, how the prices of industrial goods in the market are determined, and the same is for services. Okay, now let's proceed further. From this discussion here and your earlier reading of microeconomics, you may have already begun to understand in what way macroeconomics differs from microeconomics. To recapitulate briefly, now we are studying the difference between micro and economics. You have already learned microeconomics, what is microeconomics, and I have also introduced to you to the macroeconomics. So you may be clear about microeconomics and microeconomics difference, but we are recapitulating here. To recapitulate briefly, in microeconomics you came across individual economic agents and the nature of the motivations that drive them. So here we can see that individuals in microeconomics, they want to maximize their own satisfaction. I have highlighted here some of these variables. I will not read the whole para. We all know that producers wants to maximize their profits. We all know this. And consumer wants to maximize their satisfaction. And firms tries to maximize their profits. Even a large company, I have highlighted these three lines with the blue. Even a large company was micro in the sense that it had to act in the interest of its own shareholders, which was not necessarily the interest of the economy as a whole. So a large company, if we can say the large company Tata or any other commodity airline Jio, these companies are concerned only about their shareholders, means they are only interested to maximize their profit, and they are doing nothing about the welfare of the country. So these industries also comes under the purview of microeconomics. For macroeconomics, I have highlighted in pink color. For microeconomics, the macro meaning large phenomena affecting the economy as a whole. So in macroeconomics, what we study, phenomena which affects the economy as a whole, like inflation or unemployment, were rather not mentioned or were not taken as given. So in microeconomics, we have taken other variables, this inflation, unemployment, as constant, as these are not affecting the individual economic agents. These were not variables that individual buyers or sellers could change. So inflation and unemployment, all these conditions are studied at the whole economy level. So these these variables are not studied at the micro level, because the individual buyers and sellers cannot affect inflation or unemployment at in their individual level. Okay. Moving further, the nearest that microeconomics got to macroeconomics was what? It looked at general equilibrium. Meaning, now general equilibrium, what means general equilibrium? So microeconomics deals with economic variables in partial way. It does not study the whole economy. But in macroeconomics, we see general equilibrium. General equilibrium means the equilibrium of the market, equilibrium of the whole market. Okay, meaning the equilibrium of supply and demand in each market in the economy. Therefore, microeconomics deals with partial equilibrium analysis and macroeconomics is concerned with general equilibrium analysis. This is also the difference between micro and macro. Now moving further, you can see economic agents in the box. Okay, what are these economic agents? I have highlighted all the economic agents, but economic agents definition, what would be the definition of economic agents? I have highlighted here. Economic agents, economic units, are economic agents. We mean those individuals or institutions which take economic decisions. Those institutions and individuals who takes economic decisions. Okay, these are consumers. Consumers, what consumers do? They decide how much to consume, what to consume. Okay, producers, what producers decide? What to produce, how to produce. These are the things producers decide. And the entities like government, corporation, banks, and these are also the economic decision makers. They decides economic decision, like how much to spend. Government decides how much to spend, what interest rate to charge on the credits. Banks decide what interest rate to charge on credits. They have given loan, what would be the rate of interest they would charge. Okay, it is decided by the banks. How much to tax, it is decided by the government. So consumers, producers, government, corporation, banks, all these are economic agents. So if you are asked what are the economic agents, you need to keep these economic agents in mind. So we are proceeding to the next para. I will give their attention here. Macroeconomics tries to address situations facing the economy as a whole. Macroeconomics tries to address situations facing the economy as a whole. You can understand this line very well. Adam Smith, the founding father of modern economics, had suggested that if the buyers and sellers in each market take their decisions following their own self-interest. Keep in mind, self-interest is important word here. Following only their own self-interest, economics will not need to think of the wealth and welfare of the country as a whole separately. What Adam Smith meant to say that if the forces of demand and supply were free to play their role in the economy, then there would be no any role of the government. There is no need of anyone to take care of the economy. Everyone will be run at their own. But these things proved wrong when the depression came. Though Adam Smith and many other economists were classical economists, okay, they were of the view that whatever is produced in the economy is automatically sold. If the things are supplied, they will be consumed. There will be no problem of demand, there will be no problem of supply. And they have also thought that there would be no government interference. Okay. So this was the thinking of Adam Smith, and the economist belongs to his category. But the things proved wrong. Their thinking had no answer when the depression came in 1929. Now moving to the next para, you can see here from where the para starts. Economics found that first, in some cases the market did not or could not exist. Because we can see many situation in for many commodities market have no existence. Okay. Secondly, in some other cases markets existed but failed to produce equilibrium of demand and supply. So what classical or Adam Smith has assumed that there will be equilibrium in the automatic equilibrium in the economy due to forces of demand and supply, but there were cases where market existed but failed to produce equilibrium of demand and supply. Thirdly, and most importantly, in a large number of situations, society, most importantly word is also highlighted, most importantly, in large number of situations, there are many situations where society or state means government, okay? Government or the people as a whole had decided to pursue certain important social goals. Social goals means which are related with the welfare, okay, unselfishly in areas like employment, administration, defense, education and health, for which some of the aggregate effects of microeconomic decisions made by the individual economic agents needed to be modified. I highlighted this, needed to be modified, because the things which the economic agents take, which the other economic agents, for example consumers, producers, the decisions taken by these agents are for their own welfare or for their own self-interest. But the role of government here is also important, and Adam Smith and other economists, which includes Marshall as well, they are of the view that government has no role to play in the economy. Okay, but here we can see government also decides, state also takes some decisions for the improved the situation of the economy, and the things which are not taken into consideration by the private sector. We were here unselfishly areas like employment, administration, defense, education and health, for which some of the aggregate effects of the microeconomic decisions made by the individual economic agents need to be modified. For these purposes, macroeconomics had to study the effects in the markets of taxation and other budgetary policies. I have highlighted taxation and budgetary policies, and the policies for bringing about changes in money supply. So taxation, budgetary policy and money supply, these are the variables which the government, which the state, which the government changes, increases or decreases in order to improve the situation of the economy, in order to bring the stability in the economy. Okay, so taxation, this is the tool which tool of the fiscal policy which government uses to stabilize the economy. Budgetary policy is also the tool. In budgetary policy, expenditure of government also decide where to spend the amount the government has received from taxation. And money supply, this is affected through the Reserve Bank of India, through the central bank of the country, which also works for the favor of the government. Okay, works on the direction of the government, sorry, and the rate of interest, wages, employment and output. All these variables are affected by the government. Macroeconomics have, but before we go further, we have box here. In box there is written about Adam Smith, so it is also important because one marks question may be asked from here. So let's read this. Adam Smith, about Adam Smith, who is also called the father of economics. Okay, Adam Smith is regarded as the founding father of modern macroeconomics. It was known as political economy at that time. So earlier name of economics was political economy. Keep in mind, earlier name of economics was political economy. Now we call it economics, but earlier its name was political economy. He was a Scotsman and a professor at the University of Glasgow, philosopher by training. His well-known work, An Inquiry into the Nature and the Causes of Wealth of Nations, 1776, published in 1776. This was his book name, An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of Wealth of Nations. You need to keep it this name of book in mind. Is regarded as major comprehensive book on the subject. The passage from the book, it is not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer or the baker that we expect our dinner, but from their regard to their own interest. He meant to say the butcher, the brewer, the baker, all these people are interested about their own self-interest. They are least concerned about our dinner. Okay, so all these are concerned about their own self-interest. They want to maximize their profit. So this is the reason why these people are working. They have no concern about the welfare of anyone. We address ourselves, I have highlighted this portion with pink, we address ourselves not to their humanity but to their self-love, and never talk to them of our own necessities but of their advantage. Is often cited as an advocacy for free market economy. Okay, why free market economy exists? Because everyone is maximizing their self-interest, and in the way the economy will be in equilibrium, according to Adam Smith. The physocrats of France were prominent thinkers of political economy before Smith. So before Adam Smith, there was other group of economists called physiocrats. Physiocrats was other group of economists before classical economists, physiocrats. From where they belong? France. They belong to France. They were the thinkers of the modern, thinkers of the political economy. Okay, now we are here. Therefore, deep roots in microeconomics, because it has to study the aggregate effects of the forces of demand and supply in the market. So macroeconomics study the aggregate effects of the forces of demand and supply in the market. However, in addition, it has to deal with policies aimed at also modifying these forces. So government in between takes decisions, intervenes in the market through its different instruments. Affect government also affects the demand and supply in the market through taxation, borrowing, and through the policies of the Reserve Bank. Okay, however, in addition, it has to deal with policies aimed at modifying these forces, if necessary, to follow choices made by the society outside the market. I have highlighted with the yellow. In a developing country like India, such choices have to be made to remove or reduce unemployment, to improve access to education and primary health care for all, to provide for good administration, to provide sufficiently for the defense of the country, and so on. So there are government not only regulates the market forces, it has been to say government not only regulates the market forces, government also have to follow choices made by the society outside the market. Okay, the things which are not related with the market but with the welfare of the people, the government also takes decision on the welfare of the people. For example, consider the case of our country India. There are many decisions which the government has to take, for example, to remove the unemployment from the country, provide universal health care and education for all, to provide good administration, by the government, to provide sufficiently for the defense. All these things are considered by the government and provided by the government for the welfare of the people, and the free market economy does not provide these things. Macroeconomics shows two simple characteristics that are evident in dealing with the situation we have just listed. These are briefly mentioned below. So macroeconomics shows two simple characteristics. Now, what are these two characteristics? We will study it one by one. First characteristics is who are the macroeconomic decision makers. Now, who are the macroeconomic decision makers? Now, I have highlighted here who are the macroeconomic decision makers. Here, the state itself, I highlighted the state itself, are the statutory bodies. What are these statutory bodies? Statutory bodies are those bodies which are framed by law according to the government, according to the law of the government, law of the land, by the government of the country. Okay, these are Reserve Bank of India. These statutory bodies are Reserve Bank of India, Securities and Exchange Board of India, and similar institutions. All these institutions regulate the macroeconomic variable. RBI, you know, have different rates, CRR, repo, reverse repo, bank rate, open market operation. All these are the things through which RBI regulate the economy. Securities and Exchange Board of India, it also helps in stabilizing the economy. It deals with the securities, shares, market, etc. It is regulate and regulates the share market in the country and the market related with other securities, bonds, etc. Typically, each such body will have one or more public goals to pursue as defined by law or the Constitution of India itself. We are studying here, I have highlighted, these goals are not those of individual economic agents maximizing their private profit or welfare. Thus, the macroeconomic giants are basically different from the individual decision makers. So, what you have noticed that macroeconomic agents does not concerned about individual decisions. Okay, individual decision makers are concerned and are dealt in microeconomics. Okay, secondly, what do the macroeconomic decisions try to do? First question was, who are the macroeconomic decision makers? We have seen state statutory bodies. Okay, these are the macroeconomic decision makers. And the secondly, what these decision makers do? What these decision makers do? Obviously, they have to go behind economic objectives and try to direct deployment of economic resources. Means they have to go behind economic objectives and deployment of economic resources. Deployment of economic resources means the optimum provision of resources to different sectors. Okay, some sectors of the economy are deficient in particular resource or in particular, you know, any, if they are deficient of anything, they must be provided, and the government helps in providing the things, the facilities which they are lacking. So through different policies, monetary policy, fiscal policy, government divert the resources from one sector to the other. Okay, for example, we see that in agriculture, banks are reluctant to give loans because of high default rates, but government intervene here and provide direct banks to provide loans, direct banks through RBI to provide loans to agricultural farmers at low rate of interest. So here government intervenes. Such activities are not aimed at serving individual self-interest. They are pursued for the welfare of the country and its people as a whole. So macroeconomics concerned with policies which are concerned with the welfare of all its people. Sorry, are the people of the country as a whole. Now there is question, how macroeconomics have came into existence. So we will study emergence of macroeconomics. How this subject came into existence. We'll understand some theory behind this. This question may be asked in 3 marks. Macroeconomics as a separate branch of economics emerged after the British economist John Maynard Keynes published his celebrated book, The General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money, in 1936. What was the name of his book? The General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money. The dominant thinking in the economics before Keynes was that all the laborers who are ready to work will find employment and all the factories will be working at their full capacity. This thought of this school of thought is known as the classical tradition. I have already explained you the classical tradition. The classical economists think that whatever will be produced in the economy, it will be automatically sold and there will be equilibrium in the economy. So moving towards the books about John Maynard Keynes, we will study. So we are studying this box. This is about John Maynard Keynes. John Maynard Keynes, British economist, was born in 1883. He was educated in King's College, Cambridge, United Kingdom, and later appointed its dean. Apart from being a sharp intellectual, he actively involved in international diplomacy during the years following the First World War. He prophesied the breakdown of the peace agreement of the war in the book The Economic Consequences of the Peace, 1919. The book was published in 1919, The Economic Consequence of Peace. This was the book name. His book, General Theory of Employment, General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money, is regarded as one of the most influential economics book of the 20th century. He was also a shrewd foreign currency speculator. So his book, General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money, is basically the force which is the basically the main work, in fact, which led to the emergence of macroeconomics. Now, how macroeconomics came into existence, this is the reason behind, this question of Great Depression may be asked in 3 marks, so give your attention here. However, the Great Depression of 1929 and the subsequent years saw the output and employment level in the countries of Europe and North America fall by huge amounts. So Europe and North America was worsely hit by the Great Depression of 1929. Okay. It affected other countries of the world as well. Demand for goods in the market was low, many factories were lying idle, workers were thrown out of the jobs in USA from 1929 to 1933. Unemployment rate rose from 3% to 25%. So when depression came, it affected the market economies of the world, in fact capitalist economy of the world, worsely. Demand was very low in the economy and factories were lying idle. They were not producing anything because there was no demand in the market. Workers were out of the jobs in USA in the 4 year period from 1929 to 1933, the unemployment rises from 3% to 25%, which was huge. Unemployment rate, what is unemployment rate? It is unemployment rate may be defined as the number of people who are not working and are looking for jobs divided by the total number of people who are working and looking for jobs. This is a formula to find the unemployment rate. You can study it. Over the same period, aggregate output in the USA fell by 33%. Now, unemployment rose from 3% to 25%. Aggregate output fell by 33%. These events made economists think about the functioning of the economy in a new way. The fact that the economy may have long-lasting unemployment had to be theorized about and explained. Keynes' book was an attempt in this direction. So this was the thing that led to the emergence of macroeconomics, because the earlier theories of classical economics failed to provide the answer why this has happened, why the Great Depression has happened, because they were least concerned about demand and over the years it was seen that there was no demand in the market, which led to Great Depression of 1929. So classical theory, classical economics failed mostly, and it led to the emergence of Keynesian economics. Unlike his predecessors, his approach was to examine the working of the economy in its entirety, and examine the interdependence of different sectors. The subject of macroeconomics was war. So what you are going to read in this book, context of the present book of macroeconomics, what you are going to read in this book. So this book, I will not read the whole para. This book is about the working of the capitalist country. Okay, no doubt there are some developing countries like India where the capitalist sector has flourished well. But it is related more or less with the capitalist country. Okay. Now there are things which are explained here. Is the capital, what is capital, natural resources, labor, revenue, and the different sectors which are concerned with macro. You will read it by yourself. In short, we are in the last para, features of capitalist economy. This question may be asked in 3 marks. In short, a capitalist economy can be defined as economy in which most of the economic activities have the following characteristics. First is there is private ownership of means of production. Means of production means all this land, labor, capital, all these are owned by the private sector. Production takes place by selling the output in the market. There is sale or purchase of labor services at a price which is called the wage rate. Okay, so labor services means the labor will be purchased at the wage rate. The wage rate will be determined in the market. So in both the developed and developing countries, apart from the private capitalist sector, there is institution of state. What is the function of the state? To frame laws, to provide the public infrastructure, school, colleges, health services, I have highlighted. So here for state, we are taking the word, we are using the word government. So there are different sectors which are explained here. The household sector, business sector, external sector is related with exports and imports of goods and services, exporting capital and importing capital to foreign countries. This is the external sector. These are the four sectors which are there in macroeconomics. We will study in detail about all these factors in circular flow also. So in summary, macroeconomics deals with studies economic variables, okay, and the interlinkages of different sectors of the economy. Now what are these sectors? These four sectors: household sector, business sector, government sector, and the rest of the world sector or external sector, okay. The interlinkages between them is studied by the macroeconomics. How macroeconomics emerged? Macroeconomics emerged as a separate subject in the 1930s due to Keynes. So in this book, we shall mostly deal with the working of a capitalist economy. In the last two lines, macroeconomics sees an economy as a combination of four sectors. What are these four factors? Namely, household, firms, government, and the external sector. So this is all we will study in macroeconomics. Move towards the questions of this chapter. First question is, what is the difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics? I have already explained you in detail about the difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics in this lecture and in the previous video. Second question is, what are the important features of the capitalist economy? We have also studied that. Okay. Third question is, we describe the four major sectors of the economy according to the macroeconomic point of view. I have also told you in detail about all these sectors, and you have also read about these factors in last year in your 11th class, 11th as well. Question for number 4 was, describe the Great Depression of 1929. This is also studied in the last, at the last of the lecture. So all these questions have already been studied in very detail in this lecture. So you can write answers of these questions by yourself. That's all in this video. Let's meet in the next video. Thanks for watching.